hanging room at Wandsworth Prison being made ready for an execution. One of London's most notorious crime families was thought certain to hang for the shooting of a nightclub barman. But 28-year-old Jimmy Nash defied certainty, taught the underworld how to get away with murder.
He'd walked into the Old Bailey facing being hung for murder. That was what he was facing, purely and simply. And instead of that, he walked out of the dock with a 5-year sentence for causing grievous bodily harm on a dead man.
Jimmy Nash was no ordinary defendant. One of 6 brothers from an Islington family of gamblers, club owners, and thieves. They were the most powerful firm of criminals in London.
The Nashes were a little bit different to most other firms. They were respected all over. And you can say there was fear. There wasn't really fear from people that knew them, because they knew they weren't liberty takers. But there was tremendous respect, because they wouldn't buckle down to anyone. They never let a friend down. The most loyal people you've ever met. Everyone rallied around Jimmy. Everyone. No one wanted to see Jimmy get found guilty of a murder charge where he could have got hung.
The police file is still open, because to this day, nobody's been convicted of the murder. It took place in the same East End street where Jack the Ripper claimed his last victim. The scene of the crime was an illegal East End drinking club.
Well, the Pen Club was a squalid, dirty drinking club in Duval Street, and it was bought by 2 gangsters. The clientele were mainly criminal. The things that went on were the setting up of jobs, i.e. burglaries, robberies, call it whatever you will. That was what they foregathered for, and also to spend their ill-gotten gains after hours.
Selwyn Cooney was the barman in this den of thieves. He shared the job with Faye Sadler, the shoplifter and gangster's mole. Cooney had had an accident in his car involving one of the Nash brothers, who came off worst in the fight that followed. In the underworld, this meant retaliation was inevitable. On February 8th, 1960, at about midnight, Jimmy Nash and 2 other men arrived in the club. The police insist Nash had a gun. Publicly, he has always denied it.
As soon as these people walked into the club, the car started. A man called Billy Ambrose tried to step in, got between Nash and Cooney, and was promptly shot in the stomach. Nash then promptly and coolly shot Cooney. Shot him in the head. Cooney, in spite of what some people believe or have heard, did not give chase to Nash. He couldn't. He took one step forward, fell over a television set and died. The bullet was completely lodged in his brain.
Everyone spilled out of the club in a panic, and the police were called. Almost immediately, they had 3 witnesses who said they could identify the gunman. Ambulance men found Cooney's body dumped in the gutter. Faye Sadler was initially cooperative, but she decided the underworld's code of silence was more important than justice for her dead friend. She told the Daily Express she would never grasp and went abroad to avoid giving evidence. To men like Mickey Bloom, there's no doubt that Faye Sadler did the right thing. He's a staunch supporter of the Nashes.
If people knew of people that were going to give evidence against Jimmy Nash, or going to say, of course they'd be warned, you know, and be told they shouldn't do it, because that was the code. That's what they were supposed to do. Things happen, people get hurt, people die. All right, you know, no one likes to see someone die, but these things happen. I mean, the guy, whoever it was, done him, whoever it was, he asked for it. He asked originally to get a right-hander from Jimmy, he asked for it. And so what happened to him, you know, I've got no remorse about that at all.
Bert Wixton was a detective sergeant on the Pen Club case and went on to become one of Scotland Yard's top gang-busting detectives. He investigated 39 murders and reached the rank of commander. He was known as the Old Grey Fox.
This, I suppose you could say, is the end product to everything. The manhunt. And I'll tell you, there's nothing quite like a manhunt when you've got the real thing and you've got your murderer or whoever it is, you put them in there. And the next step to there is their prison sentence. Gives you a good feeling.
But there was no joy for the police in the Pen Club case. The first Old Bailey trial was stopped by the judge amid charges of jury nobbling. When the retrial began, two key prosecution witnesses had been attacked and slashed in the face. This was one of the first trials where witnesses and jurors received police protection. Despite this, the judge complained that witnesses were too scared to tell the truth. The underworld had been at work.
Never mind a murder case in any sort of case. If we could help them, we'd help them. It was us against them. We didn't follow society's rules, did we? We had our own rules. And people in the straight world don't understand. It's respect. It's not fear or threatening or nobbling or anything else. It's respect. People respected it.
There were all sorts of things going on at these trials, from attempted subversion of jurors to absolute intimidation of witnesses outside the court by these gangsters.
Yeah, I'll tell you the truth, I tried to follow. You know, just to say, look, he's my mate, and he didn't do it. But I never ever got near them, I don't think anyone else did either. The police really made a big thing out of nothing.
The events that led up to Cooney's death and formed the subsequent trial for murder typified the underworld's warped idea of justice. Reasonable doubt was sown into the jury's mind, and Jimmy Nash was acquitted of firing the fatal shot. He got 5 years for breaking Cooney's nose and escaped the noose.
Oh, we were shocked. Couldn't believe it. I can't believe it to this day. On the evidence was given to that court. After he went to prison, the Nashes just disappeared. Their reputation faded. They didn't come into any real big inquiries. And they had dropped into the underworld. Perhaps they'd been persuaded by the emergence of gangs such as the Krays and the Richardsons and the Callahans from South London. They were all milling around.
In 60s gangland, the North-South divide was created by the River Thames. The Nashes were true sons of North London, where the big names in the underworld were fighters and hard men. But south of the river, villains had a more business-like approach to crime. Raised in the local criminal tradition of the dodgy deal and the con trick, they were out to make money. Charlie and Eddie Richardson were two Lambeth boys who ran their own company when they were still in their teens. His brain.
And I was buying scrap metal from various businesses, and within a year I was in a fairly big wire business. By the time I was 20 years of age, it was a very well-established company.
From a humble start, Charlie Richardson built a thriving business out of other people's scrap and rags. He was soon running half a dozen yards across southeast London. But the profits from scrap alone were never enough for him. The yards became a front for a criminal empire of fraud and violence, which eventually boasted mining interests in South Africa and an office in Park Lane.
I mean, he was a shrewd businessman, there's no doubt about it. He ploughed money back into the scrapyard all the time. I mean, that bloke had a fantastic brain for buying and selling you. There's no one that could touch him. And, you know, he had a lot of government contracts which through the back door, backhanders and things like that.
Johnny Bradbury was a trusted lieutenant and childhood friend of Charlie's. He saw the Richardson's firm prosper in London's post-war development boom. It was the ideal climate for a shady dealer. Contracts were agreed with a handshake. Bad debts were settled with a right-hander. But with Charlie, it went further.
And I mean, if he wanted something, he went to see Charlie about it. If he wanted someone straightened up, he went to see Charlie about it. It wasn't a gang as, like the Mafia or something like that, you know. It's, I mean, if I called you, Frank, and I couldn't get no joy, and you live in South London, I'd go and see Charlie and say, look, Charlie, I'll give you so much out of it, just get my money back, you know, and here, take it over from there.
To help him straighten things out, Charlie recruited a man whose reputation alone was enough to promote the Richardsons into the first division of crime. To this day, throughout the underworld, Mad Frankie Fraser is respected, and that means feared.
He was a very strong principled man, not the same principles as the straight world knows, but principles that we understood, that we all hoped to achieve. A very powerful man, a fearless man. And obviously, when he went with the Richardsons, you know, it was like China getting the atom bomb. They were already a tasty firm, but him being with them, and he was a big deterrent against anyone else interfering with them, whether it be the twins or other South London firms.
Richardson, straight from jail in 1962. He'd been captured at Heathrow Airport 7 years earlier and imprisoned for his part in a revenge attack on a London gangster. At the time, Fraser was a henchman for London underworld boss Billy Hill. When Hill fell out with his former gangland partner, Jack Spott, each began plotting to kill the other. Fraser led a street attack on Spott to teach him a lesson.
I just whacked him with a shillelagh a couple of times, and someone else cut him, and that was that.
If you'd had a knife that night, what would you have done?
I'd have killed him. Would have done, yes. Because I think he deserved it.
Were you feared?
Yes. Well, I don't think so, but this is what people have told me.
So what was it in you that instilled that fear?
Either you're born with it, or I don't know. There's something there about you. Something that you're not in control of. It's natural, it's there. It's all I can say.
With Fraser on board, the Richardsons had the might to do as they pleased. As Charlie's business expanded, he had the edge over his competitors in another way too. The scrap business had brought him into contact with corrupt policemen. Sergeants he'd bribed to ignore a load of church roof lead in the 50s had been promoted, and Charlie kept in touch.
Commanders at Scotland Yard, at one time they was lowly sergeants. If we didn't pay these people money, my customers had all kind of harassment. My premises were searched. And I mean, it's a strong form of black belt, and it had to be paid. Everybody else paid the police off, every other metal merchant. If I didn't pay them off, I'd have been in a very vulnerable position.
But Charlie was never reluctant to pay the police. He knew it was a worthwhile investment. After policemen had visited his office, charges would be forgotten.
That was how it was. We just could not put a foot wrong. No matter what police station you went to, there was always someone that our local police station knew, who could contact someone there and straighten the things out. We'd tell him what it was for, and he'd go and do the deal. He'd come back and say, all right, Johnny, £50 for me, they £150. Just give him the money, and that was the last you ever heard of anything. As I said, you could not get arrested. Never.
But there were some things even Charlie couldn't arrange.
Een van die ambulansie agter my is op bystand gereed om te reageer op jou noodoproep. Maar wag.
South Africa has been Johnny Bradbury's home since he fled there in 1964 to escape arrest. He was wanted for a type of company fraud that was a Richardson speciality. Bradbury had a flair for this lucrative crime. In the early 60s, he ran a front company called Bradbury Trading. It was so successful, it became too big to cover up. This crime is still popular today. It's called a long-term fraud.
A long term fraud is getting goods under false pretenses. You get 30 days or 90 days credit. You pay for the first lot, you double your order up, pay a bit, pay another bit, then give another order, and you do six or seven firms at once. I went in bankruptcy, it was £28,000 at that time in the 60s. And that was in the case of 7 months. And that was a lot of money in the 60s, 28 grand.
It was Charlie Richardson's most successful long firm fraud. The scam was to order goods on false pretenses by setting up a network of phony companies with forged references. But first, they paid suppliers promptly to win their confidence. Then they made huge orders on credit. After delivery, the fake company and the goods disappeared overnight.
Everyone wanted to give credit. As long as you paid your first lot, the credit just came in. You can go to any firm. You know, we had leather goods, all sorts of, all kinds of things like that.
If you want to go case for the weekend, this is the most marvellous thing to take with you. Yes? No? 6 for 216.
Most of the stolen merchandise went on sale right under the noses of the police. The street markets of South London were an ideal distribution network for the Richardson's gang. The traders even told them what was in demand.
Radios was the best thing, because they just started coming out then. There were stall holders at the markets, because they wasn't paying tax on them. They got them, you know, say, 5 bob cheaper, 6 bob cheaper, and they could get them from the wholesale company. So they was queuing up for the sets. There was no problem getting rid of them.
North of the river, resentment was brewing. The Krays long firm frauds were much less successful. They believed they were entitled to a bigger slice of the action and travelled south to press their claim. The Richardsons were not impressed and sent them back empty-handed. A key member of the Kray firm recalls how much this upset Ronnie.
Richardsons were getting too much money. They were a rich firm compared to us, you know. And they didn't want to know. Clear off, he said, we don't need you. That upset him. We used to call it Indian country. Because after this meet, then it's off, it's hostile. If we went south of the river, we would hire a car, you know, with the purse on the inside of the door. And we'd have a gun in there. To Ronnie, it was an insult that they wouldn't join him. So he wanted a war anyway. And then our firm was paired off. He worked in twos. My partner was young Ronnie Hart. And we were given a target. Our target was Mottram, one of the Richardson's long firm fraudsters. And we were given all the details they can get about him. His address, his drinking habits, this sort of thing. We were all supplied with a gun. Or the whereabouts of a gun. You didn't walk around armed, just taking a piss, you know, but you knew where you could get one quick.
Who would have been the targets for Ronnie and Reggie?
The main man, Fraser. And I imagine if it had gone on, it would have come to an actual bombing at a scrapyard, get them all in one place sort of thing, or a club they use, you know. But young Haywood did it for us.
Billy Haywood was a busy South London thief. He also ran a spieler, an illegal gambling club, in a house in Lewisham. Here, Haywood's fellow thieves gambled away their ill-gotten gains. His right-hand man, who kept order in the club, was Billy Gardner.
They had the drinking upstairs and the gambling downstairs. They used to play rummy, poker, kalooki. Good living.
The Lewisham Club was a den of thieves. Gangsters weren't welcome because the gangster did to the thief what the thief did to his victim.
When you're out screwing, you're risking your liberty to get money. You're not going to let some bastard come and take it off you, are you? You know, I mean, you help other thieves, but with gangsters, if you've got something, It's like the heavyweight title of the world. They want it and don't want to fight for it.
To keep their money, the thieves had to be prepared to take the gangsters on at their own game.
They come up with lumps in their coat pockets. Then you go downstairs, lift up the CD. And how do you want it? Guess I've got to go.
What was under the settee then?
The arsenal.
Consisting of?
Handguns, shotguns, whatever.
The spieler was too successful to be ignored. It was on the Richardson's manor, but Bill Haywood wasn't paying any dues. Charlie left that side of the business to his brother Eddie, and the man the underworld called the Atom Bomb.
Eddie Richardson came up there with Frank Fraser. And then a bit of friction started there, you know, from there. They went in the back room with my pal, Bill. They weren't there long. About 15 minutes come out, disgruntled sort of thing. And I said it anyway, just in case. I put that down my belt, you know. They said they want a bit of the action here. So what did you say? He said, no, me. I said, I think it'd be some egg. He said, I know. He said, who are you with? I said, I'm with you.
Egg, or aggro, wasn't long coming, and the Richardsons wanted to see Haywood and Gardner at a nightclub in Catford called Mr. Smith's.
We got a phone call. The other mob was there. Gonna smack Bill's bum. They smack his bum, they got to smack mine and all. Anyway, we went up there and three of our boys was up there, and Henry Bums, Peter Hennessy, Dickie Arn, Bill and I had a look round, and there was about 14, 15 of them. That is 2 or 3 to 1. So, sent out for some shooters. They arrived 15 minutes. There's one end of the bar, where's the other end of the bar? And the atmosphere changed. It was all nice and cool, and then all of a sudden the tension started to rise a bit, you know. He come up, Eddie Richardson, drink up. Don't want you here no more. Putting our men on the door. No. I said, drink up, and we said, no. That way 2 or 3 geezers come up and give Bill a clump with a bayonet across the nut. Bill went and pulled a gun out of his waistband. Got caught in his brace, actually. But anyway, he let a couple go. And then all of a sudden, it was off. It kicked off.
Well, then there was fights all over the joint. And one of the men, Dickie Hart, and he's firing a revolver. Well, how he never hit anyone, one in the wall, one in the leg of a chair, what you're sitting on, one. And one of them hit a guy in the shoulder who was with us, and it burst an artery. And in seconds, he was sort of bleeding to death. You see him go. And I said to the man, who I knew, see him with the gun, I knew he'd done it. I said, drop it out, Dick. Let's get him to hospital. He's very badly hurt. But in my mind was to get him. I have to say that, because I really blamed him what he'd done. All right, he said. And 2 men, they picked him up, one by his, you know, without hurting his shoulder, and one on his legs. And I went in front of them, and they were in the middle, and Dickie Hart behind them. And each room I'm going through, and where it said exit, went through about 3. I'm looking for a weapon, anything, until the last room, the next door was the door leading, the exit door out to the street, so this was my last chance. So when I hid behind the door, And as he come through, as I say, I had nothing of me. I got a powerful punch or anything like that, but for once I did give a very good punch. Smashed him right in the mouth and with the other hand forced the gun down. But with that he done it and now I blew my leg off. Well, you know, fractured, well, broke, shattered the bone completely, my thigh bone. And the rest is history.
The rest is he was found dead,
that's right. Shot by his own gun, the gun that shot me.
After the gun battle at Mr. Smith's, one man was dead and Eddie Richardson and Frankie Fraser had gunshot wounds. The rest of the Richardson gang were on the run. In the early hours of March the 7th, 1966, one of the first men on the scene was PC George Barker driving his Wolseley 610.
I drove into Farley Road, which is which leads to the back entrance of Mr. Smith's club, and it was like a battle scene. There was glass and blood, and we came across the body of Hart laying in the gutter, which was covered. I never actually went into the club proper, but on the right-hand wall was a great smear of blood, which looked like it had been smeared with a hand. And going from memory, I just recall seeing it was obviously fresh because there were still vertical streaks of blood running down the wall. We found a pistol in the gutter and a big glass bar, 2 inches by about 1.5, with a great lump of matted hair on it. So we found a dustbin lid and covered those items. I think the operator I had with me picked up the gun. He, with his torch, then found a trail of blood, which we followed, and the blood ended at a house with a low garden wall, the privet hedge behind it. I stepped over the wall and immediately trod on somebody there who moaned. And that was where I found Frankie Fraser, and the reason being that I'd accidentally trod on his leg.
Fraser and the critically injured Dickie Hart were taken to nearby Lewisham Hospital. Doctors and nurses were unable to save Hart's life.
He was in the next cubicle to me, Hart, in a casualty, as soon as you go in. I see him die, in fact. He was blown to pieces. It was a 45. Shot through here, right the way up. Couple. It's about as near to me as I suppose you are across here, but lying, same as this table is.
And he was shot with what gun? His own gun?
His own gun.
Did you shoot him?
Well, they said I did. But I was found not guilty, and quite rightly.
Another gangland murder where nobody was convicted. Once again, the underworld called this justice.
Three of the fellows who were dismissed with that night are dead. They've been murdered in all different circumstances. Dickie Hart got murdered in Miss Smith's. Peter and Missy got murdered at a boxing match. And Buttons got shot on his front door. Over a swindle he was doing with someone, and they had the arm, went there and they opened the door and bosh. They give it to him with a double barreled. So there's only me and Bill left. Richardson's, they thought it was at the powerhouse in London. It's until one night they went into a club and they found some rough, tough old guys there. And I was one of them. And I'm proud to say I was one of them.
Haywood's gang inadvertently did the police a good turn. The Richardsons were effectively off the streets. Eddie got 5 years for a fray along with Frankie Fraser. It was a major break for Jerry MacArthur, the assistant chief constable of Hertfordshire. Within a year, he'd had them all in the dock. He was starting to accumulate the evidence he needed.
It was in October of 1965 that a man named Taggart came out to see me, because he was frightened for his life.
Jimmy Taggart, a long-firm fraudster, went to Hertfordshire Police because he feared word would get back to Charlie if he went to the Met. Taggart told MacArthur Charlie Richardson and his men had taken him to this yard in Rotherhithe. He was then subjected to a five-hour beating in order to collect a £1,200 debt.
He was obviously a man petrified. He was virtually shivering when he was speaking to me. He was terrified. And I wanted to take a statement from him, a written statement, but he wouldn't give me that statement. He said he was frightened that maybe the Richardsons somehow or other would get to know about it and he'd be in trouble again.
Taggart told MacArthur about other victims of the Richardsons' violence. Eventually, they struck a deal. Taggart would make a full statement but not sign it until Charlie Richardson and his gang were under arrest.
All right, Mr. Taggart, if you'd like to take a seat, we'll get started.
If MacArthur could not bring them to trial, then this statement and others he'd collected would be destroyed.
Sit down whenever you think is right. Tell me anything you need to know.
Okay, I'm just here, yeah?
Yes, one at a time.
Okay. Immediately on getting into the office, I was thrown to the floor and the three of them began kicking me. They were swearing at me. Then my clothing was pulled from me and I was left lying on the floor completely nude. It's difficult to remember the sequence of events, but I can remember Fraser hitting me on the head with a pole about 2 inches in diameter, which broke in two. I was thrashed with ropes and hit on the head with a pair of pliers. While Fraser was attacking me with these objects, the others were kicking and punching me.
Copy, Mr. Taylor.
MacArthur had originally planned to jail the Richardsons for their long-term frauds and extortion. But as Taggart's statement unfolded, he realised it would be easier to convict the gang on their crimes of violence.
I can remember sitting on a chair on one occasion and seeing my reflection in a window and realising how bad I looked. And this made me more determined than ever, as I thought if I did, they would finish the job and kill me. These beatings happened in spasms. On some occasions, I was made to wipe up my own blood, which was on the walls and floor with a rag they gave me. Fraser's attitude was that I would be dangerous to release, and they should finish the job off and kill me.
What's your version of what happened to Jimmy Taggart?
He didn't get touched.
Did you break a wooden pole over his head, hitting him so hard with it?
Complete rubbish. Absolute rubbish.
Beaten up, kicked in the testicles, tied to a chair?
Quoting his own evidence, after all this happened to him, this is his evidence, not mine, he drove home. He never went to hospital to have it x-rayed, the so-called fractured skull. Any other injuries, there was no record of them. And he never went to the police, the doctor about them, or anything. I think the doctor was a complete sham. I don't think he existed.
His body was one mass of black and blue bruises. Hardly any space between one bruise and another, overlapping each other in actual fact. And his back was all like stripes of black and blue, all very close together, just lines going down like that. And down below, his testicles and his groin was all, you know, like a ball, a rubber ball, the size of a rubber ball.
Dr. McAllister saw Jimmy Taggart as he hid in a friend's house in North London a few days after his beating. He was a key prosecution witness, Richardson and the rest of his gang at the Old Bailey. He vividly remembers Taggart's condition.
I saw him in bed lying spread-eagled. I was horrified at the what appeared to me was a grotesque figure, all blown up, face all swollen, black and blue all over. He must have had a terrific beating, and an expert beating at that. He was grotesque, really, literally grotesque, but there were no actual serious injuries. Now, this was the incredible thing about it.
The police began to realise there was a link between the fraudulent companies and the violence. The aim of the horrific beatings was to make sure none of the frontmen in the long firm frauds dared to name Charlie in court. The main architect of the frauds was Jack Duval. He built a pyramid of shady companies that kept money rolling in. But this brilliant con man went too far. He conned Charlie too.
Jack knew him for what he was, and he still conned him. Charlie would just not take that. He'd give you money, but he didn't like being conned for it. If you went down to Charlie and said, look, Charlie, I'm in shit, I need £100. What for, Johnny? Well, I'm in trouble with the police. Here's £100, I want it back. But to be conned, he just couldn't take that. He's got a reputation to keep up. Now, people know he's been conned and he does nothing about it. Then they all start taking liberties. So he had to put his foot down every time on it.
Jack Duval vanished abroad when he knew the game was up. One by one, Charlie pulled in Duval's associates to find out where he was. Among those summoned to his Camberwell office was a man called Bunny Bridges.
Bridges gets a message. He comes down the yard because he doesn't dream. What was going on? I mean, he'd done no wrong to Charlie, you know, as far as we knew. And he came in and he got a smack in there and said, so Bunny said, well, I don't know. What do you want him for? So Charlie said, well, he owes me thousands. And Bunny said, no, he hasn't seen him. Charlie sits behind a desk, just sort of sitting there like the Lord, you know, and he carry on till Charlie says, take him upstairs and make him tell you where Jack Duval is. So we took him up above the scrapyard. You got some offices up there what was used. We fucked him about a bit, gave him a few smacks. Then we had what we called a torture box here. It was an old field telephone. We slung Bunny in a bath of water, cold cut, and then started putting the wires on him and turning the handle, and he was screaming blue murder, you know, about the pain that was going through him. You put the wires wherever you're going to put them, on his brick or on his balls or whatever you're going to put them, on his nipples, and turn the handle. And the cold water doubles the strength of the shock that goes through you.
What was his reaction?
Well, he jumped about 4 foot in the bloody air out the bath, screaming and shouting, you know, and you give him another hole. Then we put a, tied a piece of cloth around his mouth to keep him quiet. Just carried on with the handle and that. And he could see that he didn't know nothing. I mean, he would have told us. It's obvious, you know, he couldn't take that all the time. I think you could honestly say 9 times out of 10, they didn't know nothing what was going on in the first place. They really got tortured for fuck all. Like Bridget, he didn't know nothing about Duval's business.
If you knew that and you knew it at the time, why didn't you say, no, we're not going to take him upstairs?
No, it's not a thing. You've got orders to do, you do it. Otherwise, you're liable to wind up on a torture box as well if you don't say no to Charlie.
These unspeakable acts are impossible to justify. For the police, the victims weren't ideal witnesses to put before a jury because they tended to be criminals. But MacArthur couldn't afford to wait. He was worried that the violence would escalate.
They would put it that they were a threat only to the underworld. But in reality, they're a threat to the public because they become power mad. They wouldn't hesitate to dish out violence. And the violence was such that it could only be a perverted mind that was doing it or controlling it. And it was bound to lead in the end, if it wasn't stopped, or if it hadn't already happened, it was bound to lead in the end to murder.
Charlie Richardson believed he could get away with murder. In South Africa, he was named in a sensational trial. The victim was Thomas Waldeck, a mineral prospector who had persuaded Charlie to invest tens of thousands of pounds in a mining venture. Once again, Charlie began to suspect he'd been conned. The court was told a contract killer called Harry Prince had been sent to Johannesburg. Prince teamed up with Charlie's men on the spot.
Prince took the gun. We went to Waldeck's house, parked the car outside the house. We go up to the front door, and the front door was glass, all glass. Prince rang the bell, the light come on. You could see Waldeck standing behind you. And Prince just let by, I think it was about 9 bullets he put into him. Heard Mrs. Waldeck scream, done a duck with a car, got back to the house at Victory Park. About 3 days later, the police pulled us in, me and Prince, released us for lack of evidence. But the police said they knew it was Prince, because when they were sitting down, he sweated so much, it went through the sole of his shoes to the floor, panicking.
Harry Prince vanished, but Johnny Bradbury was tried for the murder and sentenced to hang at Pretoria's maximum security prison. He'd carried out his last orders for Charlie Richardson. When the trial ended in May 1966, Bradbury was put on death row to await the rope. His sentence was eventually commuted to 11 years.
How long were you actually on death row?
10 months, 9 days.
And were there people hanged while you were there?
Oh yeah, I think it was about 80 blacks and 4 whites in my cell, and all went.
While Bradbury was on death row, British detectives flew down to see him. In statements, he confirmed crucial details about the torture and beatings and gave the police their first inside view of the Richardson's gang.
On the day that England beat Germany in the World Football Cup final, a Saturday, at 5 o'clock in the morning, I briefed a team, I think it was of 60 officers, and out I went and did all raids. Charlie was in bed, sound asleep. So we told him we were going to arrest him, and we searched his premises and found indications of fraud, passport offences and things like that. But he would insist on shaving before he came away. And all the time I could see he was thinking to himself, how am I going to get away from this? And in the bathroom when he was shaving, I said to him, now, Charlie, forget it. You are not going to escape. We will make sure of that.
Time has not dulled Johnny Bradbury's memory of his horrendous acts, nor has it sharpened his sense of morality. There's little trace of remorse, just bafflement.
But the things we done, I can't believe it myself sometimes. It was unreal. We could go and hit a bloke and put him on a torture box or break his toes with a pair of pliers or pull his teeth out. It didn't bother us. Charlie had a bar around the yard, that was our... You know, whether we had a policeman there for a drink or whether someone was tortured. You can't sit there all night and dying of thirst. And then we used to have just a brandy or whiskey we all drank then. And just have a 5-minute smoke break and start again. It was a recognised thing. More like a factory, you know, on a tea break. Can't keep going on empty stomach. We used to send round to Armit's, a pie shop or whatever we fancied, you know.
These men were so callous they took meal breaks while they tortured others. But the extent of their depravity goes beyond even this shocking detail. Many of their victims were drugged with a cocktail of alcohol and a powerful sedative to make them passive. But this very passivity spurred Bradbury and his associates onto even greater acts of brutality.
Charlie poured some of that stuff in. And he poured a lot of it in there. And the bloke now is a bit demacard. Charlie gave him a smack, Frankie Fraser gave him a smack. And then, I don't know what happened, as I said, I still can't explain it to this day, what made me do it. I said to Charlie, "We got any pliers in your drawer?" He said, "Yeah." He said, "What are you going to do?" I said, "I'm going to break his fucking toes. He won't tell us what's been going on." And Charlie gave me the pliers, and I just, you know, got his toes and bringing them this way and just snapped them off. And then he was in such a thing with his stuff that was in his drink, he didn't even feel the fucking pain. So then I got annoyed. I took the knife and I cut half his ear off. And then he was more or less unconscious with his drink stuff. So Charlie said to me and Roy, oh, just shove him in the car and dump him at a fucking hospital somewhere. And we arrived and kicked him out and left him lying. I think they found him about 3 hours later in front of the hospital there. But I still can't tell you what made me turn vicious like that. Because, I mean, it's different to putting a bloke on a torture box. You know, it's just turning an handle and it's more or less a big joke sort of thing. But when you get hold of a pair of pliers and break a bloke's toes, you know, just sit there doing it, you don't feel a fucking thing. And that's when I knew I was going the other way then.
In June 1967, the man who'd given the orders had to take some. Charlie Richardson was sentenced to 25 years for crimes of violence and demanding money with menaces. Eddie Richardson and Frank Fraser got 15 years apiece. Charlie expected the public to believe he'd been hard done by.
I smacked people about to try and obtain my own money back. There was no other people's monies involved here. I've never robbed a bank. I've never broken anybody's house. I've never robbed a security car. I've never blown anybody up with a bomb to do with me.
Society was making sure that gangsters got the message that they would no longer be allowed to get away with murder. The trial judge, Sir Frederick Lawton, is in no doubt that the punishment he gave Charlie Richardson fitted the crime.
The press are looking for good headlines, described it as the torture case. In my opinion, that was a fair description. That's really what it was about. The use of torture to obtain concessions. By the time I tried the Richardsons, I'd been in the law, what is it, for something like well over 30 years, spending most of my time, but not all of it, in the criminal courts. I'd never come across anything like this before.
Charlie Crowney's twin brothers were once professional boxers. Born in London's East End, they knew they'd have to fight to make their name. In 1951, they all appeared on the same bill at the Royal Albert Hall. Charlie Cray lost his bout. Reggie won easily and skillfully. Ronnie lost his temper and was disqualified. From early childhood, the identical twins were bound by bitter rivalry and fierce devotion. Their conviction for assaulting a policeman ended their mother's hopes for a boxing career for her sons. The family believe it was fate that turned them into heavyweight gangsters.
You see, that's where it all began from when they were children, really. I mean, it was boxing. They were very, very good. They won everything. People thought, if I could beat Reggie and Ronnie, even when they were children, then we'll have a name. And they never did win. So they kept winning, and as they got older, the same thing happened. People wanted to put the twins back on the floor. And so as it went on, it got worse, obviously, the violence, and they kept winning. And that's how it all began. They weren't running around to be Jack the Lads or be villains. It happened.
Ronnie and Reggie grew up in the post-war East End with its tradition of street violence and strong sense of community. The twins used both to increase their power in a local pub. The Krays worked hard to appear as local boys made good. But they were murderers and extortionists. They made sure cameras were on hand to help them gloss over the dark side of their activities. The twins killed people in cold blood, but the images that remain in the public's mind are of Ronnie and Reggie giving money to charity, of Reggie posing with the stars, of Ronnie hobnobbing with politicians like and the twins immortalised by the fashionable photographer David Bailey. But in the underworld, the twins were known for what they were. And as in their early boxing days, their reputation preceded them.
Obviously, once you start getting a reputation, I mean, you stand on Bow Corner, you got a reputation as a game boy. So you get someone down from Roman Road crowd, or Stratford, or Poplar, and you have a battle there, or you go and visit Mile End, or whatever, same thing. To be told that their twins were taking over was a sort of, well, something to be proud of. You know. It could have gone either way. I went the wrong way.
Big Albert Donoghue joined the firm after one of the twins shot him in the back of the leg. This was after the Krays had branded a friend of Albert's on the face with an electric poker. It was a punishment for some perceived slight against the twins, and when Albert dared to speak his mind, he became their next target.
Jewish guy, so he's got a blue chin anyways, and he hasn't shaved because he's got these... He's been branded with electric poker, you know, the wire lighter things. And we were trying to get it out of him who done it, but he wouldn't say who done it. So in the end, I got fed up with him. I said, well, if somebody done that to me, I'd blow their head off. And that was it. I walked away. If I'd known it was Ronnie, I wouldn't have changed my mind, but I'd changed my mouth. You know, I wouldn't have said it. As soon as I walked in the pub, someone said, here he is. And everything sort of hushed like hell. And in them days, you always kept the bottle because... an innocent weapon. And I felt these people drifting away from me, and I thought, oh shit, it's off now. And then bang, I turn round, and there's the other guy going like that with an automatic pistol.
Albert refused to tell the police which twin had shot him. This made him worthy of joining their firm.
They said that when your leg's better, come and work with us. In the meantime, we put you on a pension. I think it was 15 quid a week pension, which was, I suppose at the time, near enough average week's wages. You know. So that was that.
That was the moment you were on the firm?
Yeah, signed up.
Albert Donoghue became a soldier at Fort Valence, the nickname for the Krays family home at number 178. Like much of the East End, it's now been demolished. But even in its notorious heyday, it hardly resembled the fortress of Ronnie's fantasies. Here, he and his brother held court and presided over the firm's board meetings. From the front room of the Two Up, Two Down, they ran a criminal empire. The first time he set eyes on Ronnie, it was obvious to the policeman who was eventually to jail the twins that he was playing the part of an American gangster.
It was a summer's evening, and I realised that a car had drawn up immediately outside the door and looked outside. It's a big American-type car, and a guy stepped out of the car, put with his hand in his pocket, as though he had a gun in his pocket, and he sort of swept the street, looking up and down and making sure that there was no one inside, and then gave a signal, and the back door opened, and out stepped Ronnie Kray. And I was amazed because he was dressed for all the world like a 1930s Chicago gangster. He had a long, long cashmere coat that reached to his ankles, tied in a loose belt at the waist. His hair was greased and parted, and he swept across the pavement and into the pub. And he looked to me like...
Many were prepared to obediently follow the Kray twins' lead. But those were the days when the stands at Hackney Dog Track were packed with punters. Now a few loyal supporters remained, among them Tony Lambriano, clinging to the values of an age when the odds were stacked in favour of villains, and no one stopped to think about the consequences. Lambriano's loyalty cost him his liberty. He spent 15 years inside for his part in one of the Krays murders.
When you talk about fear, what is fear? It's an imagination of something. That's what fear is. I've seen frightened people, yeah. I mean, we've all done it. Every one of us has terrified someone in some way. But I think we saw it as a way of, like, earn a living. I mean, to a lawyer, for example, to solve a problem. But if you went to someone like the twins, their word was enough. I mean, the problem ended. It's proved time and time again. Their name was enough. They didn't need a firm. There was a firm, the two of them on their own. They never needed a firm. You see, the twins had to live up to this reputation. Bear that in mind. And what I mean by that is, what people want them to be, they had to be, I suppose, if I look back on it that way. So they had to be good at whatever they'd done. And believe me, they were good. The best I ever saw.
Well, I was known as Reggie's man. I mean, he didn't use words like minder, bodyguard, that sort of thing. Just, I was Reggie's man.
Did you have lots of money in your pocket?
Well, apart from the twins' pension, if you did any business with them, if you actually went on a bit of business and there was money involved, you got a slice of that. Plus, I could eat and drink for nothing, and I could get my clothes made to measure next to nothing. You needed a car, you just went to a car site in front for a couple of weeks and run it into the ground. Hardly any expenses. I was then put in charge of collecting the weekly payments from different clubs and places. And from that, I would pay out the pensions. I'd be told who to pay. And if somebody was out of favour, they wouldn't get paid that week. You know? There was no fabulous fortunes, you know? Thousands of pounds. You know?
Protection was one of the firm's main sources of income. People paid up because they were afraid. The twins couldn't afford to let their reputation for violence slip. That reputation usually ensured that their victims didn't complain to the law. Detective Inspector Nipper Reed had to sit back and wait for witnesses who would dare to speak out against the gangsters. In 1965, some 3 years before he finally arrested them, he thought he had a breakthrough. London club owner Hugh McCown complained to the police about the protection racket. The twins were charged with demanding money with menaces. They wanted 50% of the profits from his club, The Hideaway. People who knew the twins and their methods were not surprised when they were acquitted after witnesses retracted their evidence.
There's no question about what prevented witnesses giving evidence to suggest that the Krays are involved, and that was terror. Just absolute fear and terror, because the Krays generated that by their threats, by intimidation, and by their violence. People were openly saying, they won't be in long. They'll get away with it. They'll get out. And so it happened. This gave them even more confidence, even more arrogance, even more certainty that they were the kings of the underworld in the East End and that nothing could change that.
This is BBC Television.
The twins used the press to capitalise on their release.
How much has this trial cost you?
It's cost us black.
And how do you feel about that?
I suppose everyone likes the idea of spending that money for no reason at all, you know.
Does it leave you broke, or how does it leave you?
It doesn't leave us broke, but at the same time, it's a lot of money to have to pay out when one is innocent, you know.
A lot of people have got the impression from this trial that Clubland, London, is very tough. Do you think it is? You run a couple of clubs.
Well, in all clubs, you get an occasional drunk, you know, and sometimes they have to be slung out, and that's why there's doormen and that, but I suppose it's like Clubland all over the world, really. It's just the same as... I don't suppose it can be that bad, because people won't go to them, really, would they?
Ronald, what do you think about Clubland in London?
Well, I think most clubs are very respectable, you know, and I don't think there's any trouble at all in them, except occasionally.
In the East End, the twins' victory over the law only increased their power to dispense their own vicious brand of justice.
You knew if you were doing wrong, and you knew if it warranted some sort of comeback. So you were expecting it. And I've known cases where people were upset when they didn't get seen to, because it made them feel small, insignificant. You know? Scar, chip mark. They would wear them with pride, you know. Look at me, I've got a cut. It was a sign that you were a tough guy. First of all, the guy would be kidded to, made to feel easy. All right, we'll be drinking, that sort of thing. Then one would walk away from him that way, one would walk away from him that way. And then when everything was right and everybody was out of the way, they would just spring the guy. Zip. He's cut. They don't feel it. That's the first thing they do, is they look, they see the blood. And a lot of people, because they're bleeding, they're beaten. Other people, they get angry when they see their own blood, you know. But most people, as soon as they think they're bleeding, they go, whoa. Especially when they couple with the opposition, of course, you know.
Come on, everybody. Tonight is party night at the Aspen Club. Come on. Enjoy yourself. It's greater than you think. Enjoy yourself. Why you're still in the pink.
In the 60s, crime was tinged with glamour. Celebrities and villains rubbed shoulders at the Astor Club just off Berkeley Square. But violence was never far beneath the veneer of respectability. One night at the Astor, the chief henchman for the rival Richardson firm, Mayor Frankie Fraser, was entertaining the fugitive Scottish murderer Jimmy Boyle. Insults were traded when Cray associate and bank robber Eric Mason arrived on the scene.
And I walked in with these two friends of mine, and one of the Scots guys said something about my friend's broken nose, and my friend knocked him out. And all hell was let loose then, so the Richardson's, Fraser and all that felt that they had to make one against us because of their showing discourtesy to their friends from Scotland, and that's how it started. So all of a sudden a few knives come out, axes and one thing and another, and I jumped in, pulling people off my pal.
Police were called, got out the back door and bumped into Mason outside on the pavement. And he said, Reggie and Ronnie won't be pleased with what's happened here tonight. Which was nothing, even with them for that matter. And with that, I just bundled him in the car and kidnapped him.
Was he injured at all?
Well, if he wasn't injured, then he must have been the Invisible Man. Of course he was injured.
How?
With a chopper.
Injured where?
Round the head, everywhere.
They overpowered me and got me into this workshop where Fraser pulled a chopper and hit me on the head with an axe. But I put my hand up and my hand, and that scar there, my hand was pinned to my head. So I couldn't move the hand. And they tried to chop that hand, as you see them scars there, that's where they tried to chop the other hand. And they was making remarks, he won't ever fight again. You know what I mean?
He really got what he deserved. And that day, he wasn't a bad fellow, as it happened. So, you know, in that sense, he never went to the police afterwards or anything like that. No, or anything. But on that particular night, he was bang out of order.
Well, I thought I was dead, you know what I mean? I see lights and all that. I must have been come to with lights in the operating table or something, because I had 370 stitches, 3 fractures in my skull, and I was in a pretty bad state.
Mason and Fraser's fight took place as the underworld was bracing itself for all-out war between London's two major firms, the Krays and the Richardsons. This never happened, because in March 1966, the Richardsons got involved with a local gang in a gunfight at the Mr. Smith's Club in Catford. One man was shot dead. As a result, Most of the Richardsons were either under sedation or under arrest.
The Richardsons were now broke up. Some were in hospital, some were in Nick. Cornell was a loner, and he's come over to our territory. It was an insult. Ronnie took it as an insult. To us, Cornell was a finished man. He was beat. He had no backup, you know. Any one of us would have faced him in a pub, but he wouldn't have come to killing the man. There was no reason to kill him.
George Cornell was the only key member of the Richardson's firm still on the loose and had taken part in their torture sessions. He crossed the river into Cray territory to drink at the Blind Beggar pub. Legend has it that he'd called Ronnie Cray a fat puff. What's certainly true is that Cornell was afraid of no one. The pub was less than a mile from Fort Valence. Cornell was with his friend Albie Woods, who now talks publicly about that night for the first time.
The pub was completely empty. There wasn't a soul in there. So we walked right the way along the long bar, and as it bends round at the end, there was a partition there, and there's curtains by the partition which led into the public park. Jules sat in the corner, you know, we back towards the partition. I sat on the corner, facing him.
The underworld grapevine was quick to inform Ronnie Cravener. He set off with his driver and a 9mm Mauser automatic.
5 minutes went by, or maybe 10 minutes. All of a sudden, George said, look who's here. Then I realised that someone had stopped behind me. George was sneering at him. And at that instant, it was bang. The shot was fired. All I could see was one massive, big, you know, flame of smoke sort of thing, like, you know, blue. Couldn't see yours then, you know. Then I slid off my stool to duck behind the bar, and then down he came. He wasn't unconscious, he was still conscious, he was sort of moaning. So I was just saying to him, all right, George, I'm with you, like, you know. And I put a cushion underneath his head, you know, made it try to make him comfortable. He had a hole in the face, and it was pumping out onto me, you know, just pumping all the time. And I didn't see any other, you know, wounds or anything, not, you know. I was wearing a blue mohair collar and tie, and when I looked at myself, I was absolutely saturated in blood. And I just took the coat off, put it on the seat, and jumped in my car and drove to the first telephone box that I came to phone his wife, Olive.
All the police were able to get on the night was some scene of the crime photographs. Albie Woods maintained he didn't see the killer, and the other witnesses went to ground. Cornell was still alive when he arrived at the London hospital. The firm left the manor for a pub in Walthamstow. In Ronnie's mind, they were his troops, and he was their colonel.
Getting bulletins from a nurse in London Hospital, and she said, this guy's not dead. He's been shot in the head with a 9mm bullet. He's still alive. It was early hours of the morning, anyway, when we heard, came on the news that he is dead. And a cheer went up. Imagine that. The colonel cheered first, and then every the others join in. Look, I'm with you, sir, you know. Cheer because a man's dead, do you? And he's dead, that's it. That's the sort of life it was.
Their names were Ronnie and Reggie. They were twins, and as they grew, they came to understand the power of fear. They were the Krays, and their story is terrifying, because it is true. Gary and Martin Kemp star as the Krays.
Who loves you, eh?
The media loves the Krays. They've made more money selling the story from prison than they ever made as gangsters. In the razzmatazz that surrounds the twins to this day, their cold-blooded murders have been sanitized. People who were children during the Krays' reign of terror campaigned for their release. Back in the 60s, once the twins' violence had escalated to murder, hardened members of the firm realised they were completely out of control. They might even turn against their own.
The twins wouldn't send a stranger to get you, because they know you'd either do the stranger or you wouldn't show. So the person who's going to come for you is your partner. So we had a little arrangement that if he used my first name, Albert, that's a warning, and vice versa, you know. Which, like, to anyone accompanying him, if he knocked at my door and said, it's only me, Albert, no problem, don't sound like a signal, but it is, you know. And that way I'd come flying out the window with a shooter in my hand or something, you know.
For self-preservation took over. The firm's main men considered murdering the twins.
When something would happen, it would be, could have done that fat bastard last night, you know. We used to call them Gert and Daisy, the two, Reggie and Ronnie, you know. But Ronnie was vulnerable because when in car, when we're going somewhere in the car, he had to sit in the passenger seat. The people with Ronnie just sitting behind him, just take him through the tunnel and bow, he's gone, you know. Chuck him out the other side or take him somewhere and bury him, burn him, well, the problem, as we saw it, was not the twins, it was after that. If we want to carry on, we've got to build up a new f- plus we've got to handle very lightly arrest and for the actual murder of the twins. But they were definitely as much on the list as we were.
Murder is seen as a solution to a problem. Frank, the mad axeman Mitchell, became the twins' next problem. Initially, they decided to help him escape from Dartmoor Prison. Anyone who could lift two 15-stone men at arm's length would be useful muscle on the firm. Mitchell had spent 18 years inside for various crimes of violence and had been certified insane. Even at high security Dartmoor, he was allowed to wander off from outside working parties to visit the local pub because he was so difficult to control. The Krays thought it would boost their gangland reputation to help him campaign for a release date for his life sentence. The first step was to spring him from the moor.
Nobody believed it would happen. So when it was discussed, they was all, I mean, now, I don't even know where the moor is. Where's that? It's near Scotland. You're all laughing about. Anyway, like an idiot, I mentioned I'd been evacuated to a place called Ashburton in Devon, which is on the edge of the moor. Oh, well, you know where it is. Oh, shit, I'm in it now. So it's decided that me and Mad Teddy Smith, and we go and pick him up. That's all it was, a pickup. Didn't have to break him out or anything like that. No sirens going and all that rubbish. I thought we've got no chance here. Anyway, we found the only phone box in Dartmoor to park by. Mad Teddy Smith is making a moody phone call to look good to any possible passers-by. I looked up and Mitchell's come round. Oh, sugar, couldn't believe it. Here he is. Now we've got to get him in the car. We've got clothes for him and all that. Get this bloody great Tarzan type jungle knife he's made up off him. Throw it all away. Drill into him, there'd be no violence at roadblocks. Anyway, we were in London before it came on the news.
Police believe that the escaped Dartmoor prisoner, Frank Mitchell, is still on the moor. Mitchell, who's 37, has been described as the most violent criminal in Britain.
Because it wasn't unusual for Mitchell to slip away, it was several hours before the alarm was raised. The twins had not anticipated the extent of the publicity that would surround the escape. Mitchell wrote to the Times and sealed the letter with his thumbprint. He said if he got a release date, he would give himself up. But he never got that chance. The twins began to realise that Mitchell was a liability. In the underworld, it was an open secret that Reggie and Ronnie were behind the escape, just by visiting Mitchell at the Barking flat they provided as his hideaway. When the Mad Axemen started to get restless, they sent a nightclub hostess called Lisa Prescott along to keep him company.
Frank fell in love with her, that was it. You know. Then he started saying he wants to get out of this place, you know, he wants to move around, he wants to circulate. Now when this was relayed back, well, that was it, he signed his warrant then. He's now become dangerous. And the next thing I know, I'm pulled up to get him out of the flat, separate him from the girl, get him out of the flat, deliver him to a van.
Donahue was told the van would take him and Mitchell to a country hideout. He knew what would happen, but not when. Inside the van were underworld hitman Alfie Gerard, South London villain Jerry Callahan, and the much-feared armed robber and gangster Freddie Foreman. None were members of the Cray firm.
We came down the path of this flat into the Barking Road. I see the van over on the left, like a Thames van, or an Atlas, I think, in them days. So there's a guy on the pavement, he opens the door. Two guys sitting on the wheel casing on the left, they said, you sit over there, Frank, on the right wheel casing. As he slams a passenger door, these two guns just open up. Bow, 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 bow. Mitchell's on his knees and you can see him hitting him. And he's just fell back, to a double back on his own legs. Now we've done the first right, we're going to do a right, back where we started. And he started groaning, so one of them, bang, 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 three times in the, around the heart. You could see his shirt jumping. Quiet. Now we're coming up, back up to the main road. He starts groaning again, or whether it was some physical, what do they call it, reaction when you're dead. Anyway, the gun went under his ear and bow, that was the last one. Now we're at the main road, so I said, right, stop here. Because I couldn't see how the strange firm had just done this business in front of me, a middleman, and I'm not dead. Common sense told me I should be next. And I was waiting for a bullet. And I said, right, drop me here. I've got to go back and clear. I'm just talking, just to out the back door. I'm still waiting to be done as I walk away from that van. You know, the smell of gunshots, and with cordite, gunpowder, whatever it was, but I had a big old Crombie overcoat on. I got out of there and I had to. It was cold night, but I had to walk along with it wide open, get rid of the stink of this. Plus, I was sweating like a pig, I tell you. Because hairs on the back of your neck, it was on the whole up the back of my head they were standing up. I was expecting a bang any minute. You know.
Reggie's trusted lieutenant walked back to the flat where a terrified Lisa Prescott was waiting. She had heard the shots that ended Mitchell's 11 days of freedom. Albert gave every surface of the flat a wet and dry wipe to get rid of any fingerprints. Then he rang the twins, who told him to bring Lisa over. She was prepared for the worst.
But on the way there in the car, the girl said something I'll never forget. Connie Whitehead's driving at the moment, and he's laughing and joking. His normal self. He doesn't know what's happened. So she said, will you promise me when it's my turn that you do it? I said, what are you talking about? She said, well, I think you'd do it quick. Not.
The pair were driven to the firm's Christmas party. It was the day before Christmas Eve. Lisa managed to convince the twins she wouldn't talk. Ronnie was more interested in what Donahue had to say.
Now, Ronnie Krays here, and I've got to go over this detail by detail to him at least half a dozen times. His eyes are shining. And, tell me again. Oh, God. And then they all cleared off, and I stayed the night there with Lisa. I think we were both in need of a little bit of comfort, you know. And I was still nervous. I think it was a week later when I was asked to deliver the £1,000 to Foreman's Pub. Because I thought, what better? You know, they've had a think. So that night I was told up as well. If that guy had coughed, I'd have shot him. To me, it was common sense that I should go. And I'm pretty sure that since if one of them or both of these, them two are watching this, I bet they're nodding, saying, yeah, we should have done. There you go, lucky.
Frank Mitchell's body has never been found and no one convicted of his murder. Detective Inspector Nipper Reed based the Cray investigation at Tintagel House, south of the Thames near Vauxhall, well away from Scotland Yard, where the twins were rumoured to have friends. Everyone took the influence of the Krays seriously. 18 months after Mitchell's disappearance, the police brought in Lisa Prescott for questioning, and she was still very much in fear of her life.
But when they came over Lambeth Bridge, she realised they were going away from the yard and not towards it. In fact, they were, of course, going to Tintagel House. And so she leapt out of the car, and one of my officers fell out and followed her, and just stopped her jumping over the bridge. She was about to kill herself. She believed completely that these lads were from the Krays and that they'd been sent to go away with her.
This tremendous power to terrify was the Kray twins' greatest weapon.
Ronnie just had to glare at some people when they shit themselves. And that was one of his favourite tricks. He would sit in a pub or a club where we were, and people would be brought in for various reasons, and he could just sit there and stare at this person for half an hour, and that person he hasn't said a word to him, but that person's gone away and thoroughly cowed, you know. Been told off without a word. That was how much fear that he generated.
In the warped world of the twins, their next victim, Jack the Hat McVitie, caused his own death.
And when people go into the McVitie murder, if ever a man thought about his own death, if you want to put it that way, or if ever a man was the cause of his own murder, here's a case that stands in the shoulders of everyone else. And I'll explain why. He had outrageously challenged them time and time again. He had picked up phones throughout the East End pubs and that, pretend to phone them up and mug them off. He was warned, knock on the head. He had turned up at the Regency Club with a shotgun, drunk and peeled out of his head, knowing one of them was in there and threatened to shoot him. They got to hear about these things. Now, you must remember, in their position, how far could they let him go?
The twins never provoked a row in their life. They was provoked. They either got killed or they retaliated. I mean, they didn't want violence. It was put to them all the time. It's hard to understand until you've been there and seen it.
Jack McVitie, a small-time villain often out of his head on pills, was invited to a flat in Evering Road in Hackney on the 28th of October 1967. The twins had commandeered the place for the night ordering the girls who lived there to leave. Jack the Hat thought Tony Lumbriano was taking him to a party.
There's four of us in a car, in his car. There's a Zodiac, two-tone, Mark II. There's me, there's Jack the Hat driving. We arrive at every roadie park down the side, and we get out and we walk into the door. Get along the passage and down a flight of steps. As we walk in, I was the first one in. Now, I was very, very surprised to see Ronnie Cray there, number one. Reggie walked over to me, and Jack was directly behind me.
Jack the Hat had been lured into a trap.
Reggie pulled in from behind and tried to shoot him in the head, but the gun failed to go off. And he clicked it a few times, and then he sat down, and there was a bit of talk. What have I done? And then Reggie took him from there. You know what you've done, Jack. Now it comes to an end. He stood up and walked over the window, and he punched the pane out the window. That was when it was said he tried to dive through it. He never dived or attempted to dive through that window. He punched it in that he had been set up. Now, the next thing that happened, I turned around and there's a carving knife, a normal carving bread knife in his hands that obviously someone had picked up from the kitchen. And the next thing, it was over. I saw it, I think he stabbed him twice, three times away. I didn't actually see it because I turned away. And the next thing, he's lying on the floor. Now, it was said that Reggie pinned him to the floor with a knife. That, through the throat, total, never happened. Could you imagine that happening? What, I mean, the fact that he'd been stabbed three times, I think the first one killed him. That's what I think happened there. I mean, it was over, it was done. Now, no one knows what to do. It's happened. We've got an event on our hands. What amazed me, the twins said, get rid of him, Tony, just like that. And they went.
Jack McRitty's body has never been found.
Obviously, I regret a life being lost. I mean, you must do that, whatever way you look at it. Like, there's a point there, that he wore the grass or anything like that. It's just his way of life clashed with ours.
Men who could casually dismiss murder were recruited by the twins and moulded into a firm that could swing into action and cover up the evidence of their crimes.
My job is to decorate. And these girls have been left to clear up the pools of blood, not just spatters, puddles. And they had to mop it up and keep emptying their base and start again. Then I had to paint, dig out some bits of plaster fill, tar paper, then wallpaper, the whole place inside out.
The police didn't even know there'd been a murder until 6 months later, where an informant told them. Around the hastily repaired window and beneath the layers of wallpaper, they found traces of blood. Those close to Reggie knew his twin had been pressurising him to commit murder.
Christ, I couldn't understand it. The guy had never done him any harm, you know what I mean? He was just pill popper, ladies' man, life and soul of the party. I know it was just Reggie's answer to Ronnie's Cornell. When Ronnie got drunk and he was heavy on his pills, he would be screaming at him, "You cowardly bastard, I've done mine. Now it's time you skinny slag, it's about time you done yours." You know. Simple as that. There's no secret about that at all. You ain't got the guts. You know.
Exactly 1 year after the murder of Jack the Hat, the Cray twins were arrested after a night out at the Astor Club. Armed police broke down the door of the council flat where they still live with their mum. A total of 26 people were arrested as the police rounded up the firm. They had believed they were untouchable, but their power depended on fear, and now there was no one left to enforce it. One by one, witnesses came forward to testify against the Krays. He boasted that if he hadn't been in court, he'd probably have been with Judy Garland. But his days of mingling with celebrities were over. For murdering Cornell and McVitie, the The twins got life with a 30-year recommendation.
It was a reflection of what the judge felt was the right penalty for the crimes that they'd committed. I think he saw them for what they were, as arrogant leaders of a gang that had warped the society of the East End, committed brazen and quite gratuitous murders without regard to the lives and the considerations of other people. And they terrorised the whole of an area of London.
The sentences for the 10 members of the firm totaled 159 years. This is what Ronnie and Reggie saw as an armed convoy drove them to Durham Jail after the trial. Ronnie is unlikely to ever be released from Broadmoor, and Reggie has been continually refused parole.
Their arrogance is still apparent. They've both written two books. There is not one sign of repentance or remorse. In fact, they both savour the fact. Ronnie Cray talks about the delight that he still enjoys at remembering how he shot Cornell. Reggie Cray says he's no regrets about having stabbed to death poor Jack McVitie. So there was no question of any remorse. There was no feeling that, yes, we were wrong, we were bad, we were evil. They've never said that.
For the twins and their supporters, there's still too much at stake to admit that they were wrong. If they deny their past, they'll have nothing left. Tony Lambriano is still on licence for the murder of Jack the Hat. He's proud of the fact that he never grasped, even though it meant 15 years in jail.
I was a villain, I was a criminal. So I'm not going to stand and point the finger or blame anyone for my downfall. The choice was mine. And at least I can stand and look in the mirror and say, oh, I never point the finger or put them away in any way whatsoever. I can live with it. That's not what I'm about. And if anything you can come out of with pride with, that is something that I never put them where they are today or any of the other men involved.
But the twins had no more respect for the code of the underworld than they have for the laws of straight society. On remand in Brixton, they ordered other members of the firm to take the rap for their murders.
Ronnie turns to me, he said, don't worry about the case. He said, what we're going to do, not would you mind, what we're going to do, we want you to take Frank Mitchell. I said, no. Oh, he said, and we'll take all the frauds and violence. Shit, you can get out of that, you know, just frighten a few people, they don't give evidence. So I said, no. And now I get the benefit. Now, that's it, I know, I've crossed the line now. I'm now an enemy.
Donoghue wasn't prepared to do time for a crime he had not committed. He told the police everything about the murder of Frank Mitchell. But no one was convicted because the judge felt the evidence of a former member of the firm could not be trusted without corroboration.
Once we get to trial and I start giving the evidence, then everybody stands back in amazement. Wow, look, here's this former member of the firm. He's spun right round and now he's Queen's evidence. They don't know anything about the reasons. They don't know why. And they say, supergrass. And I think that was the birth of the phrase, supergrass. And that was it. They became supergrass number one, I think. I wound up with 2 years. And this obviously set a lot of people thinking, wow. And a lot of them bought diaries out of that, I think.
2 years for murder instead of life. The underworld got the message that being a supergrass paid off.
The dramatic appearance of krays, the climax came when Ronnie Cray was in the witness box himself and was being goaded very effectively by the prosecutor, Mr. Jones. he eventually fell apart and screamed at Mr. Jones, "You great fat slob." Jones just let that sink into the jury. Here was the king of the underworld descending to name-calling. And if anybody was the great fat slob, it was Ronnie Cray.
On the 5th of March 1969, both Ronnie and Reggie Cray were found guilty of the charges brought against them.
It wasn't a surprise at all. They expected, they said they would get 30 years. They told the barrister, they told the screws in prison in Brixton they would get 30 years, and they did.
I was absolutely overwhelmed. I realised that if somebody had said something to me, I couldn't answer because I was full with emotion. Because this was now a situation that had been going on so long. You know, my whole reputation, my life depended on this almost. It was a fulfillment of an enormous undertaking by my squad. And I felt justified that they'd done all the work that was necessary of them and that we'd achieved something, really achieved something.
Aunt Violet, myself and Mum was in the kitchen and we was listening to the wireless. And when it came on that they'd got 30 years, you know, we was dumbstruck, really. We couldn't believe it, and Aunt Violet looked at Mother and she said, "Oh, I think they've made a mistake." She said, "I'm sure they have." She said, "Maybe they'll say later, it's not so long."
"I'm not going to waste words on you. In my view, society has earned a rest from your activities, and I recommend that you be held for at least 30 years.
It amazes me that a gang that was so badly organized, badly thought out, badly managed, could be so successful. The only way it worked was because their public relations was brilliant.
I feel they were a part of the 60s, like the minicar and Twiggy and other things. You know, they were a part of it.
Billy Hill and Jack Spot had a sort of notoriety, but they hardly promoted themselves, and the other notorious East End villains, Burke and Hare, went about their murdering fairly quietly, and Jack the Ripper may have left a note, but he was hardly exactly photographed with royals.
They attracted people to them. You know, people who they should look up to finished up looking up to them, sort of thing. And Ronnie, he was his own man, you know. Nobody was going to tell him what to do. He was the boss.
He was much more a gangster for the thrill of being dominant and powerful rather than money. And perhaps this was expedited by his mental condition that took pleasure in violence. And of course, this was a factor in their ultimate.
The twins have now served over two-thirds of their sentence. They were released for one day in 1982 to attend the funeral of their mother, Violet. Ronnie is now a psychiatric patient at Broadmoor and could stay there indefinitely. Reggie is still at Lewis Prison. The government have given no indication that he will be considered for parole.
What's special about the Cray twins compared to any other gangsters is simply that they were twins. I don't think there'll ever be criminals like them again. They're like Romulus and Remus. It was only the existence of the other that made the one.